Well, good evening, everyone. Great to see you tonight. Welcome to the Todd Lecture Series for the fall. Let me do a few administrative announcements first. If you have a mobile phone and you need to use it, put it on vibrate, please. If you don't need it, just shut it on, off. That would be great. So I'm Rich Snyder. I have the honor and privilege of being the president of Norwich. And we're not only joined by this group here, but we have a live cyber audience as well. And we're live streaming the Todd Lecture Series to all of our alums that are across the globe, as well as all of our graduate students as well. So to all of you on the internet, let us welcome you. And we wish you could be here with us personally, but we're thrilled with wherever you are, and we're very glad you're with us tonight. So this lecture series, and especially for all the rooks that are in the room, is in honor of U.S. Army retired Major General and the Norwich President Emeritus, W. Russell Todd, who was in the class of 1950, and his late wife, Carol Todd, in gratitude for their dedicated service, not only to Norwich University, but to the entire Northfield community. It was founded in 2008. The Todd Lecture Series is made possible by the generosity of Ellen and John Drew, the Todd's daughter and son-in-law, and the Drew Foundation. Both General Todd and John Drew are here, and I'm going to ask them to stand. I want you to give them a big Norwich welcome home. Thank you, sirs. It's great to have them both back on campus. Great to see you. So Norwich is in the middle of a five-year countdown to our bicentennial in 2019. And in 2016 and 17, the academic year, we're celebrating the year of leadership. For nearly 200 years, Norwich University has been a living leadership laboratory. All of our students are challenged to grow and to engage in experiential learning, which is exactly what Captain Partridge had in mind for our students. This evening's speaker has been ranked as one of the top leadership speakers in the world. A successful entrepreneur, author, respected humanitarian. And it's going to be my privilege to introduce you tonight to our speaker, Marilyn Tam. Marilyn Tam is formerly the CEO of Aveda, also was the president of Reebok Apparel and Retail Group, the vice president of Nike, and is a successful entrepreneur who has built four companies. She is currently the CEO of Marilyn Tam & Company and founder and executive director of the US Foundation. In addition to being ranked a top leadership speaker by Inc. magazine, she's also been recognized as one of the four most prominent names in ethical business globally. She is a regular contributor to Huffington Post and now to live a happy, healthy, successful, and dynamic, balanced life. She's been writing on that issue. From her childhood in Hong Kong to her successes in international business, Dr. Tam has had an extraordinary, diverse life. In addition to her successes as an entrepreneur and as a CEO, she is the co-founder and executive director of the US Foundation, which I mentioned, an organization whose mission is to facilitate global action plans and dialogue to address social, economic, and environmental issues. She has served two terms as the director on a national board of the SCORE Association, a resource partner for the U.S. Small Business Administration. She's been honored with the Artemis Award for her business and humanitarian work by the government of Greece and the Reebok Human Rights Award, and has received a Lifetime Achievement Award from eWomen's Network. Dr. Tam's book, The Happiness Choice, has been named one of the top three most read books by everyone in business. After her lecture, she will be taking questions and answers from a very smart audience. Aaron Temkin, our wonderful dean of the School of Professional Schools, I've asked him to manage the questions, And he will do that, and he'll explain that when he comes up after her distinguished talk. Let's give her a big, warm Norwich welcome. Marilyn Tam.
Thank you. Good evening. I've had the pleasure of spending most of the day with some of you, and it's great to see more of you here because I have to say, I'm so impressed by the questions I receive, the enthusiasm you show, and the, just the attitude. So I said to your president, it really indicates that the culture, the expression, and the vision that is shared here really gives me hope for our country and for the world. So first, thank you very much for being here, for being who you are, because you are our tomorrow, and I can relax at one time and know that it's gonna be well taken care of. So thank you very much. The topic tonight is called The Happiness Choice, Creating Success and Happiness at School, Work, and Beyond. And I was asked to speak about this because of your leadership year. And so I want to say, what does that mean, happiness, and how does that relate to choice? And how does that relate to leadership? And we're going to talk about some of those topics tonight. And the first thing I want to say is that happiness is all about you, because it's really about you and your expectation. Because ultimately, we choose everything we have in our lives. So my intention tonight is to share with you that happiness is a choice, that I'm going to put some personal faces on the topic, and then to teach you and to work with you on what is your life purpose. I talked about this with many of the students today because some of them are graduating, some of them in grad school, and some of them are just starting out. But all of them, the questions came out as, how do I go from here, and how do I go from here in a way that serves the world, serves myself, have balance, and is ethical? So nothing easier than to have an anchor to know where you want to go if you have that anchor inside of you. And then, of course, how do you take yourself, the decisions that will take you from where you are to where you want to go? And then we talked about today is about dynamic life balance. Because our world is so busy now, and as you know, that what information we get in a day is what our grandparents got in a lifetime. And so the influx of information makes for a very complex and demanding life. So how do we balance that in a way that serves ourselves, our community, our personal relationships, and the world? And then, of course, it would be remiss of me if I didn't give you some principles and tools to take away from there. And of course, what you can do here, and you do so well, is how you can learn and share from each other, and how we can have fun in the process, because ultimately, that's really why we're here, right? To have fun. And so I said, I'll start with telling a personal story. So the personal story to start with, this is my story. You see that girl with a giant bow in her hair? That's me. I was born a second child in a very traditional Chinese family. And if you know anything about Chinese families, that is already some indication of how my life would be like. To combine with that, my birth was followed very quickly by the birth of three younger brothers. This is what we would in marketing call very poor positioning. For that, I was treated very poorly. In fact, physically abused and all the attendant things one would think about. In fact, having been told many a time that I was a poor excuse for a pregnancy, and why don't I just disappear? So this is not exactly what one would call building your morale or building your self-esteem or confidence. And at age 7, the good news and bad news, I was given away. I was given away to my aunt and uncle who lived in the country, and they didn't have any children of their own. And so I went from the town to this area called Taipo. It's a little fishing village. My uncle lived there with my aunt, of course, and I became what now we would call child labor. There was no such term then, and so I just knew that these are some of the fisher kids, because it's by the ocean that I would play with. These, not specifically those kids, but that's what they look like, and those are the age. The one standing on the wall there is probably about 9, and the other one's 7, so I was right in that age range. So there, I learned how to embroider, how to assemble plastic flowers, and to embroider handbags. But my life wasn't so bad, because I wasn't beat all the time, and I wasn't told I was worthless all the time, and so that's, in a way, an improvement. And also, I learned certain things. What I learned was hard work pays, because as meager as my wages was, I actually made some money. What I also learned was that don't question authority, because obviously my life was not mine to make any decisions. Where I lived, who I reported to, who I called my caregivers were not anything that I had choice in. And then also, there's an upper limit to how far a person can rise in life. Now, if I still believe these things now, would I be standing here talking to you? So, I'm going to ask you a question. What are you hanging on to now that's keeping you from being all that you can be? Because all at different times in our lives, we get messages that do not serve us. It's up to us to choose which ones we keep and which ones we discard. We're talking about choice, we're talking about leadership, we're talking about happiness. So what messages are we holding on to that's keeping us back from being all we can be? And what are we doing about communicating those messages to others that's also keeping them back from being who they are, potentially have the ability to be? So at age 11, my aunt gave birth to their first child. It was a boy. So all of a sudden, I was not needed again. And I got shipped back to Kowloon, where my parents lived. I have to say, my parents were not poor. It was not because they could not afford me. It was a conscious choice. They did not want another girl. So I went back to a family knowing that I was not wanted, which is not a comfortable place to be, obviously. But being a wealthy family, they don't want a child who would embarrass them by being uneducated. So I went to a very great private school, and I really caught up with my studies, and that I have always to give gratitude for that I learned there. But also at that age, my life changed. I found my life purpose. I met my schoolmate, Rebecca. This is where she lived. She was a scholarship student at the school. She and her whole family lived in a place like this. It would be 3 families shared the apartment, and Rebecca and her family of 5, father, mother, brother, sister, and Rebecca shared one room. And the front of the apartment was converted to a sort of a sundry store so that they could make a little extra money. By the end of the month, Rebecca and her family did not have enough money to have food. They had 2 stools that the 3 kids would share to do the homework on the bunk beds that the whole family shared. I was filled with outrage. As bad as my life was, I always had enough to eat. I really did not understand why 2 parents working full time could not afford to feed the family. It was not right, it was not fair, and I was going to do something about it. But I'm still 11 years old. So what do you do when you find your life purpose? Because my life purpose was to change people's worlds so they would be better, so they'd be happier and healthier. But with this massive goal, how do I translate it into this 11-year-old body going to school? The good news and bad news was I had reference points. And we all have reference points. It's what we choose as our reference point. television wasn't that great when I was growing up, and we didn't have the internet. It was a long time ago when I grew up. And so what was my restaurant point? It was National Geographic. I would love to read those magazines, and I see, what, a lot of people from Africa. And they look like they needed help. So I said, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to grow up and go help the peace people in Africa. I'm going to teach them how to feed themselves and how to run the government. Why not? I mean, I was told I was worthless. I can't do anything. I can only do anything. Because the expectations for me are so low. I don't have any fear of failure because I've already failed as far as they're concerned. So why don't I reach high? So whatever your programming is, whatever you've been told, you can flip it around and find the positive in it. Because it's very easy for a person like the situation I was in to say, I give up. I can't do anything because I am worthless. Or you can say, what can I do now that I have a vision? What do I do now that I have a passion? How do I fulfill it? And what is the opportunity for me to make a difference? Because the expectations for me to do anything is so low, I can only do better than that. So if you have a difficult background, if you have an opportunity to do better, seize it. Seize it and grow with it, because that's really what we're here for. To serve and to grow and to lead. And you all have leaders that you look up to and work with here. And isn't that exciting? So going back to my 11-year-old body, now that I have my mission, now that I have the goals and steps towards a mission, what do I have to do next? I need to get an education if I'm going to teach people how to do all these things. So I didn't finish high school. I came to this country halfway through high school because I got early acceptance into college. Because I was very motivated to study and learn so that I can help serve. So I came to Oregon. Beautiful, isn't it? Very much like Vermont. It's sort of like the Vermont of the West Coast, except we get lots of rain instead of lots of snow. Same thing. We still have mud season in both places. So I went there, and to me, today is one of the most beautiful places in the world. But when I was a teen, coming from a tropical area with one pair of shoes, which I ruined the first week in the rain, and I didn't have money for another pair of shoes for the rest of the winter, what do you do? It was scary. The space was so big, it was so cold, and I didn't know anybody, and I was too young and too poor to have a car to drive anyway. So what do you do? If you have a purpose, if you have the ability to do something that you really want, and you're dedicated to the mission, you will find a way. Obstacles are just something to be overcome if you know what you want. So I found some things called Dr. Scholl's. You know what those are? It's kind of like Birkenstocks for the younger people who may not be familiar with Dr. Scholl's. Dr. Scholl's is basically a wood sandal with a leather strap on top. And they're very durable, obviously, because they're made of wood with a rubber bottom. So I bought a pair of those. They were $12.95, I still remember. It was a lot of money for me, but $12.95. But they lasted me my whole college. In the rain, the water runs right through. It doesn't rain. It doesn't snow that much, so it's okay. I can ride it on bicycle with it. I got to be quite good because I had to go work at the A&W where I made roasted chicken and tater tots because I had to make a living to go to school. So obstacles are just things for us to overcome. If we have a dream, if we believe in what we're going to do, it's more important than whatever is in front of us that's blocking us from the path. I could very easily have given up in any of these points. Being young, being scared, being cold, being poor. There were so many other ways I could have gone than just try to keep going to school and trying to make it through. But my dream, and you all have a dream, that's what's going to keep me going when times get tough. And you know what? Times are going to get tough sometimes, but they're also going to get better if you believe. So My dream, as you know, was to go to help people in Africa. And the way I thought doing that was to go to work with WHO, World Health Organization. So when I was getting done with grad school, I applied to WHO, and I got a form letter back, and it said, we require for all people that join the organization to have 10 years experience. I wasn't 21 yet. So obviously, I did not have 10 years experience. You never have the feeling your life is passing before your eyes because everything is just, everything you work for your whole life to that point is now stopped. So what do you do when you run your head into the wall? You don't keep running your head into the wall, you step back and say, wait a minute, what do I still have? I still have my education, I still have my passion for life, and I have the passion to serve, so what can I do next? And so that's really what we have to do when we get into obstacles, is to step back and assess where you are and how you can move forward in a different way. So I did what most college students did. I went to the recruitment office and looked at the board where all the schools have listed the companies that are coming to interview. I go down the board and there's a company called May Department Stores, which now you know as Macy's. And I said, I don't know anything about retail. This is a good place to practice my interviewing skills because I never thought I needed to do this. So I signed up to get interviewed and they shared with me a few things that really got me interested in this company called May Department Stores. First they said was that they graded based on merit. Now you have to remember who I am. Small, immigrant, woman, color, and young, because I was younger than most of my classmates because I got done early even with my graduate degrees and everything. So when somebody tells me they are going to rate me, they are going to promote me, they're going to look at me based on what I can do instead of what I look like and who my outward appearance is, that's really very interesting to me because then I feel like I have a chance. I'm not negated before I start. And all of us have in times where we feel like we're negated because of something out of our control. And so we have to always go back and say, where do we find that balance? Where do we find that grounding so that we have the ability to be all that we can be? So that opened my ears up. I didn't know much about retail, but I figured I could learn. And then I said, okay, but my real purpose in life is to serve, to make a difference in the world. What does retail have to do with anything? So I started researching the company. And I found that they actually do humanitarian service. They actually are very active in the community. And so there was many points. And then I realized something else. A lot of times what we do is we have this grandiose idea and we do nothing until we get to that point. We just live our lives, our mediocre lives, until one day we're going to get to this benchmark, then we're going to do all these great things we're going to do. It's funny how that benchmark will keep moving as we go. So the only thing you can really do to make a difference is to say, what can I do today? And that was the lesson I learned then. I'm not going to Africa and changing the world at this moment. But I can make a change in the people around me, in my community, and I'll see where this leads. And so that's how I started my career, completely by accident, because I interviewed at some place where I thought I could practice. So we talked about life purpose. That's a north point of your personal compass. That's how you're gonna navigate towards your goal. Because for me, that was knowing what it is that's important to me, to serve and make a difference. That was my north point. And you can navigate from wherever you are. And as you can tell, by this time, I've already had several setbacks, how to go from there. And then you can leverage that to move you to the changing environment. Because the one thing we do know is that our environment is going to change. And something else that happened was, as I started rising in the rank in work and career, was people would ask me what they thought were polite questions, like, where do your parents live? Who are your parents? Where'd you go to school? In so many ways, they're trying to say, you don't look like a successful business executive. How can you get there? It must be some secret, like your parents are really rich, or they're well-connected, or you went to a Ivy League school, or something that gave you the edge that no other person like you should deserve to have this position. So I decided I needed to write a book. Not because I needed the book, but because I wanted to share with other people that you already have the assets you need to get what you want. And so the next time somebody asked me that question, I could just say, here, read this. But the point really was, you can start from where you are by using what you've got to get what you want. And so that's another step in my career. And in 2007, I won, as your president said, the Lifetime Achievement Award. And when I got it, I said, am I not too young for Lifetime? Shouldn't I be like really old and retired? You know, why are you giving it to me now? You know, 20 years from now or something? And they said, we want to change the face of what success and achievement looks like, and which reaching to people who have achieved a lot in life, who are still able to achieve much more, to change the face of what we believe in. And so all of you already have accomplished so much in your life, so give yourself a life achievement award for where you are now, because you're going to get many more of them. But the changing the thinking of what lifetime achievement is about is really where we are, because in today's world, all of you will have at least six careers before you retire, at least. But if you don't have six, don't worry, I have many more than that, so I'll make up an average. But the truth is, most of you have many more careers than what you think. So get used to it. We're not on a sailboat. We're in a kayak, and we're in rough water. So enjoy the view and learn how to turn over if you tip over. So, and as your president also mentioned, I got the Artemis Award. And one of the notable things that I want to share with you is I was put on a Greek step. So I just want to show you, it actually works. I sent myself a card just to make sure. But in America, you never think about being on a stamp. You know why? Because you have to be dead to be on a stamp. So in America, most of us do not aspire to be on a stamp yet. But I'm sharing this with you, why? Because I want to share with you that it doesn't matter where you come from. Your achievements and their possibilities are much more than you can ever think of. It's possible. For somebody who is told that I'm worth less than dirt, I sure came a long way. But what really gives me joy are not those achievements, as much as they're great, is what I did, because I did not forget my past. I did not forget the vows I made about making a difference in the world. We started and established with, when I was at Reebok, apparel labor standards for all the countries we worked in, so that people, workers had breaks, they had ventilation, they had lights, things you don't even think about. But imagine working in a room with almost no windows, very little light, and the fumes, and the lint, and the heat, and the lack of opportunity to go and do bodily functions that are necessary for all of us. To have those things are amazing. To have all that, have age limits of when they can start work, and have wages that really pay for them. When I got that achieved, not only in all of performing countries, but to have it part of the US labor standards, I really felt like I did something that I was set up to do. Even though I never went to Africa as a worker, even though I never did feed them or teach them how to run the government, I made a difference in some other way that gave back to where I came from. And so it's to be flexible with what your actual production is, as long as you keep sight of your goal. And in Aveda, we had another project. I was talking to one of your alums from 1971 who was talking about sustainability. And how do you get into sustainability issues when you're a corporation? A lot of times, we think that we have to be in a special place, we have to be a special person to make a change. Anybody, in whatever your work you do, you can make a change, you can do something positive. Being the CEO of Aveda gave me an opportunity to look at what we're doing. Already all the products were organic, already they were all plant-based, but how else can we help? How else can we make it even better? And that was in looking at the people living in the Amazon. We were doing a lot of damage there, we meaning the developed nations. First we went in and leveled the rainforest and put in rubber plantations. Then rubber got to be less than worthwhile because synthetics were cheaper. And then we leveled more of the rainforest to do grow hamburgers, basically cattle for our meat. And I don't know if you know this, but the rainforest land is very shallow. The good nutrients is only a few inches thick. And once it's been logged and the rains come, the land becomes very infertile. So it's not as if they have this wonderful bounty that can keep going. So what happened to the local people? They've been displaced twice. From hunting gatherers, they also became rubber tappers. And then next thing, they became cattle growers. And these are both completely foreign to their livelihood. So how can I, as a little person in the scheme of life, make a difference? Well, there's where the synergy comes in. What are we looking for? We're looking at organic plants and flowers to put on our bodies, to put our hair, to put in our skin. And what do they have in the Amazon? They have plants they've been using for generations to put on their bodies and to put on their hair and to change their coloring. Isn't that what we're looking for? So we went to the Amazon and we worked with indigenous people there. And what we did was help them replant these native plants, Uruku, so that we can have the benefit of basically human-tested products that we could use that would also give them a respectable livelihood back into their culture. So wherever you are, whether you're in the apparel business like I was, or you're in the cosmetic business, or a technology business, engineering business, there's a way for you to look at your picture, bigger picture. You step back and say, how can I impact my world in a positive way? It doesn't have to be so grandiose, but I'm just giving you examples from my life. And also I do a lot of humanitarian work, working with a lot of children and people from developing nations. This is a village down in a place called Nandi Hills outside of Bangalore, where I was the tallest and fattest person there. And you have to say, it's pretty sad, because I'm really not that tall, and I don't think I'm that fat yet either. So but it's sobering to see that 45 minutes away was Bangalore, when a hotel room was $200-something a night, and 45 minutes away is Nandi Hills, where people make 40 rupees, which is about a dollar a week. So it's sobering what we can do. And this is in another area in Kashi, where we're feeding children and giving them anti-parasitics and vitamin A for growth, because children don't get enough vitamin A by age 10. Their brain growth, cognitive growth, and vision is permanently damaged. And this is, there's a Copenhagen conference where over 50 economists got together and designated that micronutrients, which is what we're talking about here, vitamin A and things like that, is the most effective use of humanitarian resources. So it's something I've done for some time. So as you can tell, my life is really kind of full. And So work-life balance, which is an issue that came up today, is an issue for all of us in today. So how do we address it? That goes back to our life purpose. Because if you know what you believe in, if you know your North Point, then you can navigate towards your goals, whatever they are, depending on your life stage. Because what you need today is going to be different from what you're going to need 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 20 years, 50 years from now. And then you can leverage it and move forward. So sometimes we say there's no choice. And I just want to read this quote. I did not write it. When we are no longer able to change a situation, we're challenged to change ourselves. Everything can be taken away from a man, but one thing, the last of the human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's way. Because a lot of times, not a lot of times, at least some other time, you're going to have an opportunity to be in a situation where you feel like you cannot change it. But you can change yourself. You can change your perspective. You can change your happiness choice. And this was said by a person who, by all accounts and purposes, really had no choice. This was said by Viktor Frankl. He's a Holocaust survivor. He's a therapist. And he shared this in his Man's Search for Ultimate Meaning. He's a therapist, a psychiatrist who started logotherapy. And he's talking about choice and achieving happiness and survival. He noticed in Auschwitz, which is where he was incarcerated, that there are three types of people. There's the optimist, there's the pessimist, and the people like himself who chose to anchor themselves. The optimist died first because they think, tomorrow they're going to give us Thanksgiving. Tomorrow, okay, no Thanksgiving. Tomorrow they're going to give us release. They didn't get, and pretty soon they got discouraged and they died. Because conditions are bad and you get vulnerable to all the diseases and all the other things. And then the pessimists, they're going to kill us tomorrow. Oh, they're going to kill us tomorrow. Tomorrow comes, they don't kill them. But they're always hanging over their heads. So they also gave up. The only people that survived were people like themselves who said, I choose what I think. I choose how I want to maintain my dignity in spite of all the outside circumstances. And so when we say we have a choice, we truly do, even in the worst and most dire of circumstances. So I just want to just put a little perspective. This is not just my words that we're talking about. It's talking about people who have really experienced what we think complete lack of choice and come out and survive, and not only survive, but thrive and create a huge body of work, which is still so meaningful today. So why is happiness so important? Because happiness gives you creativity and productivity. And to give you some statistics, Gallup research, very valid body of work, showed in 2013 that the United States alone lost $550 billion, as in the B, in productivity due to unhappiness and lack of well-being. Those are serious numbers. Those are sobering numbers. And then when I talk to corporations, then they realize that really, making my workers happy, making employees happy, is not a nice to have. This is something that is meaningful. This is something that's going to return an investment to me and to the organization and to the planet. And so the cost of unhappiness is very high. I mentioned the first one. And the second one is because when we care or when we don't care about your jobs, about what you're doing, you don't show up consistently, you produce less, and your quality of work suffers. Why? Because you really don't care enough. Of course you care to get a paycheck. Of course you care enough to try to get a good grade. But if you're not really committed, you're not going to do the best you can. And because workers perform best, everybody performs best when they're happily engaged in what they do and making progress in meaningful work. So you have to, and you have to define what is meaningful. Because what you do has to be meaningful to you, which may be meaningful to, different to somebody else. And this was done with the health research. I worked with Jim Harder, who is the head of gut research, as well as from this study from Harvard Business School about the progress principle. So this is very well documented that these factors of happiness and productivity, creativity, is very important. And something else that I should have mentioned also is that longevity is another issue that comes up. When you're happy, you live longer, you're healthier, and your relationships improve. So it's very important that you understand what makes you happy. So leadership, we're talking about leadership, and we're talking about what makes for a good leader and what makes for a good company. And again, speaking to the gentleman who graduated in 71, and he was talking about how do we get women in leadership and why is that important? Financial returns above average when we have more balance in the leadership. We may not get to 50-50 right away, but if we get closer, and it will really make a difference. And you get better recruitment and better retention of talented workers throughout. And then you get stronger customer relationships and better decisions because there's a wide variety of viewpoints. I'm not saying this myself. This came from a survey of 366 companies by McKinsey & Company. And McKinsey & Company, as you know, is one of the leading consultant companies in the world. And so this is very recent research from 2014 showing that these are the factors, and that's why balanced leadership is so important to us, to your company, to our world. So the question we're talking about is, so we think happiness is so important. What are the decisions we make to make sure that we are happier? The first one we all know about. People say, if I have so much more money, I'll be happy. If I have this more, I'll be happy. It usually factors down to some possession. You know, is it the car? Is it a house? Is it a second house? Is it more toys? Is it more electronics? Is it a facelift? You know, it could be anything that costs money. But the point is, we spend most of our lives thinking about money and spending our work about making money. It gets out of balance. Why is it out of balance? Because the first thing that usually goes is our body. Because we spend too much time, too much energy doing work, income producing work. And we get tremendously stressed out. We may not get enough sleep. We could have a car accident on the way home, obvious way, or it could be a heart attack, it could be digestive issues, and it could be weight issues. All these, if you go down a pharmacy, you see rows of things about headache medicine, stomach medicine, and all these other things that come from stress. So if we spent a little less time making money and spent a little time focusing on our body, you wouldn't have to spend the money to take care of your body, whether it is to get a personal trainer, your own personal chef, or just a psychiatrist to fix your head. And then what else goes? Relationships. Because you haven't spent the time with your relationships. And what do? They try to buy their relationships. Presents, therapy, get rid of that particular spouse and buy a new one. It all happens. We know that. Or you don't have a spouse and you're going on Tinder or whatever trying to get a date. But it all comes back to money. Now, we just balance our life a little bit. We probably won't have to do that because they'll be naturally in your life already. So after all these three things, and I know because I consult with a lot of Fortune 100 CEOs, they have these first three well taken care of. They have lots of money. They take care of their bodies. They have a personal trainer come in every day. They have a personal chef. They get all that taken care of, and they're on the fourth spouse, and they're quite happy with them. But there's something still missing in their lives, and that is the spiritual life. There's a hollowness when we don't have something bigger than ourselves to deal with. And I'm not saying that you ought to be religious. You just have to something you believe in. Is it God? Is it nature? What do you call it? Doesn't matter. But you have to have something to believe in, that you're not just this little clod of protoplasm here for a certain number of years and you're done. Because then it gets a little hollow after a while. So think of what it is that would give you that meaning. And even if you're an atheist, you believe firmly that there's nothing that gives you that anchor. But you have to believe in something. And the last one is community. A lot of times, every one of us came into this world completely helpless. We had to be taken care of by people for years before we could even fend for ourselves. And even now, many of you here are still depending on the kindness and generosity of your parents or your caretakers or caregivers to put you through school. And one day, when we get done with all this, we go out and we work and we serve. And even now, you can give out and serve. And when we get old, we need the help and support of others too. So in between time, doesn't it make sense for us to give back? The circle is complete when we do that. So ultimately, we're talking about these five factors in our lives. Too often in our society, especially in the Western world, the focus is on making money, because of all the benefits supposedly it brings. But all the benefits are really quite superficial when you compare it to these other factors. So at every point in your life, these factors may change in importance, but they're all there, and they have to be accounted for. So when you're aware of them, and you're out of balance, make it temporary. Make it so that you know at times, you're gonna have to come back into balance. So those are the five decisions you make every moment, knowing consciously, I'm choosing this over that, and why? And be happy with it. Once you make the choice, be happy with it. Because if you're not, choose something else. So it's knowing there and being satisfied with what the decision you make. Because a person is happiest, healthiest, and most successful when he or she is making a positive difference, taking care of themselves, physically, mentally, spiritually, and have loving relationships. And this came from a longevity project, which is an 8-decade study that was done in New York by these two professors, where they show that people live longer when they have these balanced lives, and they're happier, healthier, and their relationships are better. So it's not just my telling you this, this has been quite well documented, that when you make decisions based on the five factors, it's much more lasting and satisfying than if you took any one of the other factors and say, this is it. So I talked a lot about different things. I want to share the story about how the apparel labor laws came about, because everything I talked about is sort of abstract. I want to pull it together into a concrete story. I already mentioned that I help establish the labor standard for apparel workers. How that came about is I looked at my work and my purpose, which is to make a positive difference, make people healthier and happier, and I know about the apparel workers and having the issue. So I brought it up into my company, and being president is it's helpful because people listen to you. But I shared it with my group. My CFO was absolutely against it. My production people were against it. My merchandising people were against it. My marketing people were against it. My sales people were absolutely against it. They said, how can you change the pricing? How can you demand these things? It'll make us uncompetitive. It'll make us slower. Our quality will suffer. And we're going to lose out in the marketplace. Our goods will be going to be more expensive. They're going to be late, and you know, you name it. So again, being president, you get some privileges, like you get to make a decision. But we always want to make decision collaboratively. We don't want to make a decision based on my opinion. So how do you bring something about which is a challenge for some of your people? How do you bring about an issue that they seem to center around money into the other factors, into body, our bodies, the workers' bodies, their relationships, their spiritual life, and their community? So thinking all these things, I said, okay, because it's not just about me changing the world. I need to have my team to own up with me to do it. So I have to think of their bodies, their all the other factors we talk about. So I said, okay, let's find one of our big factory groups that we work with, because these factory groups are usually in many countries. We'll go to one of their top factories, and we'll go to one of their medium to low factories that we work with. And we'll talk to the leader, the owner, basically, of all the factory and say, since we have a big pencil, which is what we call when you have purchasing power, we would like to work this scenario with you where we can take one of your top factories and one of your, you know, low to medium factories, and we're going to change how you work there. All the factors we talked about, ventilation, lighting, food, et cetera, et cetera. So we're making partners here. We're working together to make this happen. Everybody knowing that, you know, it goes wrong, it's limited damage because we're not doing the whole production, we're just doing two factories. Of course, it's still a lot of money, but at least it's manageable in the scheme of life. Now I can get the buy-in from my group. So with that, we started the experiment. Well, you know what? Production was ahead of time, quality was better, we had less wastage, we had less damage, and we didn't have to air the goods, so we saved money there too. And that's how we started changing the whole industry. Because we could prove, and we started rolling out to the other factories of this owner, and to the more factories, and then eventually to all our production countries. And then we started doing this in the industry. And then we started spreading it to all the other manufacturers, because we don't want to keep this to ourselves, because ultimately, we want the whole industry to change. So the first thing I did was, I would call Nike. I used to be there. I can call them up and say, hey, let's do this together. Well, I got completely shut down, because they thought that I was trying to sabotage them. But who came in then? The nonprofits. Because they could see it could be done, that you can be successful without slave labor, without all these conditions. You can actually be successful. They've had the clout then to, if you remember the 90s, to boycott Nike. And that's really what changed the industry. So it takes many people in many communities to come together to change money, body, you know, your relationships, your spiritual beliefs, and your community all have to come together to make real change. So when we think about change and we make decisions, it comes back to all these five factors. So again, to get your life purpose, we talked about this today with some of the students, and they said, how do you find your life purpose? I said, don't worry, many people still don't know it, and they're much older than you. But so these are some of the questions to ask. What makes you feel fulfilled? And what makes you feel happy and at peace? When do those noises in your head stop? You know those voices that you should have, you could have, you shouldn't have? Why did you do that? Those voices, when do they stop? What are you doing when they stop? That's what you want to go after. You want those voices to quiet down. You want those voices to be aligned and say, you are in your zone. We all have a zone. And that's when you're living your life purpose. So what do you want to be remembered for? because you made a lot of money? Or did you make an impact on your world at whatever level? Is your work fulfilling your life purpose? And are you committed to participating and contributing to the mission that you're involved in? So if you can answer those questions, you're going to find your life purpose. The first time, you may not find it right away, but in time, that's that little voice inside of you that's always been there is going to be heard. Because most of the time, the voices we hear is from the media, from people around you saying, oh, you're really good in math, you should do this. Or you'd be happy if you have this big car. Or you'd be happy if you had this position. But only you know what's going to really make you happy. And that's when you're going to be most creative and most productive. So I want to share a cautionary tale. I talked about being in the Amazon and working with the people down there. And it sounds so great because we made all this change. But sometimes even great things don't last forever. I've left Aveda some years ago, and they continued the program. They still have it on their website promoting Ruku. But what's happened since then is that these people that we work with, these tribes, are basically hunter-gatherers. So it's really not their world, but it was the best they could do based on where they have been marginalized to, you know, from rubber tapping to cattle and on and on. So friction and faction started in their ranks. So now they have two leaders fighting over a thing. And over time, as the quantities of the products grew, and this is raw, you have to remember these are plants. So they're not like little powders. There's giant plants and things that have to be processed. And the way up in the river in the Amazon, so you have to truck it down and float it down the river because it's the only way you can do this because there's no, you know, roads and things like that, trains. And because it's a natural product and it's so hot and humid, when you ship mass quantities, you get a lot of spoilage before you get to where the processing point is. So you really have to invest in a processing point somewhere halfway in between to reduce the mass, at least to a smaller quantity, before you ship it down to really fine processing. So as wonderful as these stories are, there's this degree of reality and how do you compensate and adjust as things happen. And are you willing to still work with that when it seems to be so difficult? Do you give up on this dream? Do you give up on this concept? Do you give up on what could be a way to change production, a way to change manufacturing, a way to change the world when it's not productive or creative or money-making right away? Or it changes from being money-making to now a good marketing story. So to understand and weigh those things and how do you move from there, ultimately thinking it is about a happiness choice. So define your life purpose, research and make it actionable, determine the steps needed to achieve it, and follow through. And then, of course, keep assessing the course along the way. So these are things we have to do to keep going forward at every step because things change, the world changes. And we change. So I want to talk about short-term versus long-term. Short-term, that looks really delicious. Thank goodness you all had dinner, so you're not going, I have to have all this dessert right away. But if we think long-term, if we just gorge on all this, we're going to have some certain issues long-term, like obesity. And even shorter-term, like a high-fat hangover. And impact on the rest of your day. You know what happens when you eat something too heavy? It impacts the rest of your day. So thinking of short-term versus long-term benefit goes back to what we'll be talking about happiness. Sometimes they may be short-term sacrifice, if you will, or moderation, so that we have long-term benefits. So we're talking about purpose, and I'm going to quote somebody else again. When you're inspired by some great purpose, you will find yourself in a new, great, and wonderful world. Dormant forces, faculties, and talents become alive, and you discover yourself to be a greater person by far than you've ever dreamed yourself to be. This was written by somebody who understands about power and flexibility. This was written by the founder of yoga. Power and flexibility. And that's really where we have to go, to understand that we have to be powerful, but we also have to be flexible. And that's really the only way we're going to survive and thrive in this world. So here's a question. How many people see a frog? How many people see a horse? There's a horse and a frog in it. For the people who see the frog, the eyes are on the top left-hand side of your picture. See the frog now? See the eyes there? Everybody see the frog? Yes? Okay, now, if you want to see the horse, the ears are where that looks like water, pointing to your right-hand side, the right-hand side of the page. See it now? And the mane is on the bottom. Everybody see the horse now? So why am I showing you a frog and a horse? Because there's a big picture and a little picture in everything you do. The little picture is what you're experiencing at this moment. At the same time, you're creating a big picture of your life. So when you're frustrated or you're dealing with some factor, and you say, okay, I'm in the frog now, where's my horse? So I just want to give you a pictorial image that you're always in a frog and a horse at the same time. So new lessons that I learned in my life. First one is, I am not limited by my immediate circumstances, and neither are you. With mission, I can accomplish what I really want. Living by my principles, I can achieve success in business and in life. And I have the privilege to share my lessons with others. And so do you. So now I'm going to ask you a question. What have you learned? What have you learned in your life? What have you learned tonight? And how are you going to use it? So the realization that I want you to take away with is that you already have the assets you need to achieve your goals, your dreams. Because we come in with those inside of ourselves, and then they're inherent. You just have to just let them blossom. You can get the training. You can do whatever. Remember, this was an 11-year-old kid who nobody would even speak to, and my reference point was National Geographic. You, too, can do whatever it is that you want to do. Not my life, you live your life. The second one is, now all you do is leverage what you already have to go towards your goals. So, this is from Sheryl Sandberg, and she said, a career is no longer like a ladder, it's like a jungle gym, which means it's not straight up and down. You may take detours, you may go down, sideways, climb up, go down again. But the main thing is to remember to have fun in the process. Because each step, however interesting or painful it might be, is leading you someplace that you want to go. Because you chose your path. It's your happiness choice. So I'm going to get everybody up right now. It's not going to hurt. Please stand up. We're going to do this together. This is a Chinese word. I wrote it myself. And Chinese is a pictorial language, which means it's made out of symbols. And so the word is called Tai, which means great. Within Tai, there's actually several components. The first component is the first big vertical line, the horizontal that comes down here on this side, and then the one goes on the other side. Just those two lines alone, the word is human. When you add the line that goes across the top, the word becomes big. And when you add that dot, the word becomes great. So why am I getting you up? Because we're going to do this together. Okay, not going to be scary. It's quite easy, and it's, you're going to like it, I promise. So you can take a hand, doesn't matter, either one, because we're going to use both. So you can take one hand, and you're going to reach up to the heavens, sky, whatever you want to call that up there. And you're going to bring down the biggest power you know. You can call it God, Allah, Jesus, Buddha, Muhammad, whatever you think is the nature, nothingness, whatever it is that you think is the greatest power you know. You can bring it down and pull it through your body all the way and ground it into one side. Now you're going to use your other hand, whichever one you didn't use before. You're going to pull in that same power from all the way up to the infinite heaven, and you're going to bring it down, and you're going to ground on the other side. So what you've done is you connected heaven, the universe, whatever is the highest, through your body to the earth. When you do that, you're human. Because you're manifesting all the beauty and power of the universe in this form called a human being. So now you're going to open your arms up wide. Don't hit your neighbor. What you're doing then is you're embracing everybody in this room, which is really easy, right? Because you like them. You like these people, right? So, but you're embracing the whole world. And then you're pretty big. But only when you give back from your core, from your life purpose to the world, are you great. Let's do that one more time, okay? What do you think? Ready? Okay. Bring that universal power, whatever you want to call it, the most powerful energy you know, through your body and ground it on one side. Okay, we're going to do it on the inside. Pull it down. Hello, human beings. Let's embrace all these nice people and everybody in the world and all the beings, because we are connected to everything and we are part of everything and they're part of us. So we have to find that place where we can share and love and really respect everyone. And then we're going to give from our core, our being, our life purpose back to the world. And so, thank you, you great people. So you've been a great audience. Do you want me to stay down here?
Should I take a couple of questions?
Oh, sure. Thanks.
So Marilyn is going to take a couple questions. So there should be a mic on either aisle. And typically we ask, I'm going to ask the students, if any students want to ask a question, to go to this mic. If any of our guests who are not students want to ask a question, we'll go to this mic. Come on, don't be shy. All right, great. You guys are usually really good at this. All right, please. First question.
Good evening, ma'am. My name is Rafael Ruiz Taz. I'm a mechanical engineer. I know we met earlier. I told you a story about myself. All right, so my question is, really, I don't care about an answer. I just want to know your opinion on this. There's an election going on, and tomorrow we're going to pick the candidate. What everyone's talking about is really what Trump is doing and what Donald Trump has said and what Donald Trump has been accused of. That's what everyone's talking about. That's what the mainstream media is telling us. But nobody's talking about Hillary's stances. She has repeatedly said that she wants to impose a no-fly zone in Syria. But who controls the airspace in Syria? Russia does. If we want to do what she wants us to do, we have to go into conflict with Russia. What does that mean? That means another war that we have to go into. Nobody's talking about that. Nobody here wants to talk about that. I just want to know. I don't want an answer because there's really no answer. I mean, the election's tomorrow. We have to vote. I'm going to go vote for Hillary. I would just like you to hear your opinion on this, ma'am, if I could please have your opinion.
I think that when we talk politics, when we talk at an issue, we can find fault on both candidates. And I think in this election, I think we have two candidates who are both flawed. I can't say that either one is perfect. In fact, far from. But I don't think that this is our position at this gathering to talk about something that really is a single issue that we're talking about, and that's not for us to influence or share. I voted already because, you know, I'm gonna be traveling, so I voted absentee. The thing is, you have to vote your conscience, and that really is up to each individual, and to say, do we degenerate into civil war, which is what it's looking like, and it's very sad because I've never seen such uncivil exchange at any level. If this was happening in my company, they'd both be fired. I'm sorry, because it's not acceptable to treat other people, regardless, without respect at any level. And I don't think our candidates is honoring our country or honoring how we appear in the world. So I don't think it's something that to pour on issue. I'm sure we can find another issue on the other candidates who has similar issues that would bring us to war. So I don't think this is a good forum to discuss something that really is appropriate. I would say vote your conscience, vote what you feel is really true for you, for us to come back together. Whoever wins, we're gonna have a lot of healing to do. Because whatever we have done so far is we've divided this country based on issues and based on fear that has really hurt all of us as a union. And it doesn't bode well for how we look in the world. I mean, if I was in another country looking at us, I was kind of like, is this the best they can do? This is supposed to be the best country in the world?
Can I ask the next student to ask a question?
Ms. Tam, Liam Carroll, we spoke today. What would you say is your biggest failure in leadership?
My biggest failure in leadership probably is sometimes not admitting that I can't do something because I so much want to accomplish whatever I put out to do. And so, but I have built teams that question me. So I have this comfort that if I'm doing something that doesn't have as high level of success because of my commitment, my team would question me. So in that sense, I'm saved by my own work because I have encouraged them to question me when it gets to the point where I'm being too stubborn, or I just don't want to admit failure. If it's something that's principled and something that is such a commitment, especially for the good of, you know, a bigger whole, I have a tendency to try harder. But then we have to know when to say stop. And sometimes that's painful. But knowing that that is a failing, I just say, stop me, question me. Let's have a conversation. So in that sense, we don't get to the point where I actually fail because collectively we come ahead and get out of it. And you know, in time you learn because when you're young and hot-headed, you think you can do anything. You know, you can do anything. But there's some things you can't do because there's politics, There's geography, there's finances, there's things that's always been that you can't change soon enough. So all those come in the way, and then in time, you learn. You learn this, okay, this is when I have to stop.
Thank you, ma'am.
Another question?
Good evening, ma'am. My name is Recruit Marciano. I was wondering, what was one of your darkest moments throughout your career, and how did you go about overcoming it?
I actually shared this today. It's a really long story, so I'm trying to shortcut it. It's going to be difficult, but I will try my best. Because it was the saddest moment in my career. It was I was president of Reebok, and doing well, company doing well, mom doing well, and it came across into the era that you all grew up with, which is soccer became important. And we didn't have expertise in soccer because America is not that big in soccer. So we had to import talent, and we had to try to find somebody who already had the expertise in soccer at a high level to come in. And soccer is a different culture. It's not ours. It comes from a different, and the standards and the ethics in a lot of the soccer world, both professionally and in the manufacturing realm, are filled with a lot of things that we would not accept in this country. Bribery and other things that you can imagine that happens. So we eventually hired, over my protests, a person to run soccer for the company, which began to bring the company down in terms of ethics, in terms of our cohesion, in terms of collaboration. And I fought that for quite a while, 10 months, because the chairman, who was my boss, wanted so bad, not just him, but the pressure from the stockholders, because we're a public company, was that we need to expand in soccer. And this man at that time was the best talent available. I mean, there's talent that's not available. You can only dress talent who are willing to come. And this man was, quote, the best talent available, but he had a very unethical manner of doing business for many, many ways. And the darkest time was when I decided I had to leave because I was not doing enough good there. And this person was just making the company that I used to love and establish, and which at the time was one of the best companies in the world, was bringing it down. And it took 3 years after I left before he was terminated, which is a term they very seldom use in business. Usually they say they leave for professional reasons or personal reasons or whatever. They actually use the word terminated because he had 4 sexual harassment suits from people in the company, as well as corruption issues from around the world on the factories where he was accepting bribes and pushing for bribes. So I felt like really a dark time to have to leave my team who were all suffering badly because I felt like I couldn't stay any longer because I could not help them. This person was too manipulative and too powerful because of the time for me to have an opportunity to shift the game. So it was great when he finally let go, but the company never recovered from that. And some years later, Adidas bought Reebok. So from one of the best, most well-run, respected athletic companies in the world is now a second tier. And so the moral of the story is that one person at the right position can take a company down. And so that's always been a pain for me because I couldn't make the shift. I couldn't make it happen. But I didn't have what it took. I didn't have the chairman supporting me at the level I needed to. I didn't have the stockholders saying, let this guy go. We can win some other way. Things happen like that. And you just have to say, how long can I stay? Because when I stay, I'm condoning the situation. So it was very sad for me to leave, for my team to see me go. But the good news is, you know, most of the people, my leaders then, including my assistants, still are friends now, because they know that we all did our best. But it was sad to see a world-class number one tier company become now a second tier company, all from one person, because it changed the whole dynamic and culture.
Thank you, ma'am.
One more question.
Good evening, ma'am. My name is Angelina Coronado. I'm currently a communications major in the class of 2020. I found it really empowering how you developed your life from something that wasn't very well at first. And I know that during some dark times, there's always little things that we tell ourselves, like it's always going to get better. I was wondering, during those dark times, what was your like life motto? How did you push yourself through the days, and has it stuck with you?
We all have certain things that keep us going. And when I was young, I had two things that kept me going. One was the name my grandfather gave me. My grandfather died when I was 7, so I really didn't know him very well. But he gave me my Chinese name. Marilyn's given to me by my mother. But my Chinese name is He Li. And that is actually the name of two emperors in China. One known for his peace and governance, and the other one known for his strategy and prowess in wartime. It's a huge, powerful name, usually given the firstborn son of a very prominent family. I have no idea why my grandfather gave me that name, because as I said, I was only 7 years old when he died. But I always took that to know in my heart that I was worth something. Somebody believed in me, that I wasn't just an accident that happened, that I was not worse than dirt. So I had that in me. And every one of you have somebody or have somebodies that at some time told you that you're worthwhile, that you're special, that you're going to do something meaningful with your life. You're going to change the world, at least your piece of it. That is what you take when things get bad. And the other thing I always had, because I used to try to hide in trees and go into nature so that they can't find me, because when I'm found, it's usually not a pleasant moment. There in nature, I found the power of spirit. And what that gave me was the knowledge that even these people who can control my physical being cannot control my spirit. Very much like Viktor Frankl, I had the idea that I am bigger than this body. I am bigger than these obstacles that I'm facing. So throughout my life, I've always gone back to those two things. I'm here for a reason, and so are you all. And two, that reason is bigger than any being that we know on this planet. So with that, you can all survive and thrive, because that's why you're here. You were not born as an accident. You're born to be gloriously proud and amazing. That's why we're here.
Thank you.
Sorry that we didn't have time for all the students who are lined up for questions. I do know that's a little disappointing. I'm going to ask you to give me two more minutes of your attention so that we can leave the aisle clear for Marilyn Tam to make her exit and get on her way. I wanted to mention, we have made innovation and its relationship to leadership a focus of this year's march up to our bicentennial. This fantastic lecture was really the kickoff for several activities during the year. Students, you may have already seen there have been posters around for the first Innovation Challenge, which we held in October, and you should keep an eye out, please, for maroon and gold posters with a big light bulb that says New Idea, spelled N-U Idea, emblazoned across the top. Innovation Challenges are short creative problem-solving competitions, and we give prizes. They include lunch and last only 45 minutes, and we did one in October, we're doing one in November and one in December. The next one is November 17th, next week, at 12:15 in the North Instruction Room. And I hope after hearing this inspiring lecture that several of you will come and kind of will fill that room up with innovative thoughts. In January, we're holding a startup weekend, a three-day intensive, and we hope fun, introduction to developing a new venture. This program will be from January 20th through the 22nd, Friday through Sunday, right after we get back, the first weekend after we return in the spring. This week-long competition invites student teams to conceive, elaborate, and plan for a new venture, such as a new business, a social service, a not-for-profit organization, or website, or maybe just an app. Participating students will work with several of our alumni, and we have a lot of business leaders among our alumni, and local business leaders, to shape a project plan and an innovation pitch. The weekend will conclude with a presentation of each team's idea. While this is only open to students this first time around, we're hoping this will be such a big hit that we'll actually be able to open it up to the greater Vermont community the following year. And then at the end of the school year, on Thursday, April 27th, at 7 p.m., we'll be holding another Todd lecture, the bookend to this event, a panel to broadly discuss the relationship between leadership and innovation. And while the panelists are still being confirmed, I can let you know that we are lining up a design innovator, a social innovator, and a technology innovator. And that evening will also include the opening of an exhibit showcasing the best innovative work of our students as realized in their undergraduate research, their capstone projects, and the best results from this startup weekend that we're holding in January. And I assure you, especially if you're coming from the outside, you'll be really amazed and impressed with what our students come up with in these kinds of contexts. So keep an eye out for information via Norwich notices if you're on campus, or flyers around campus, and for those of you that are guests for local information in our local news outlets. And with that, I thank you very much for joining us this evening and for sticking around these last few minutes. And I say have a good evening, remember to vote tomorrow, and be safe driving home. Good night.